Fleas. Fleas belong to the class Insecta, order Siphonaptera, and family Pelecidae. There are over 2,000 species of fleas, but for this video, we'll focus on the cat and dog flea. The fairly common cat flea is the Tenocephalides felis, and the less common dog flea is the Tenocephalides canis, Tenocephalides meaning cockle or comb-like head. Their comb or tenidia are these little bristles that can be helpful for their identification. These ones here, behind the first thoracic segment, are the pronotal tenidia. And these ones here, close to the mouth and cheeks, are the genal tenidia. Other flea species can have only one or none of these features. To differentiate between the cat and dog flea, we look at their genal tenidia. If they're about the same size, it's Tenocephalides felis. If the first one is shorter than all the rest, it's Tenocephalides canis. Even though they're called cat and dog fleas, they're not host specific. You can find a cat flea on a dog and a dog flea on a cat. They even suck on humans if neither are present. They prefer dogs and cats though. A dog or cat can pick up fleas from the environment where a flea-infested animal frequents, or from a very heavily parasitized animal. Emphasis on very heavily because unless there's just way too many fleas on that one animal, fleas rarely leave the nice comfy host that they've got. It's a misconception that fleas jump from one host to another. In a couple of days, the fleas start to lay eggs on their new host. The eggs are not sticky, so they fall off the host and accumulate in places where the animal usually rests. When the eggs hatch, the first stage larva will crawl out. They feed on organic debris like dead skin, hair, and especially adult flea feces that also fall off the animal. Flea feces, or flea dirt, are pretty much particles of dried blood. If moistened on a piece of filter paper, a red halo of hemoglobin diffuses out of it. The larval stage is also the stage where they may ingest Dipelidium caninum eggs, serving as this tapeworm's intermediate host. They molt twice, first into the second stage larvae, and then to the third stage larvae. Then they spin a cocoon and pupate. The cocoon is very sticky, and dirt and dust often adhere to it. After about 3 to 4 weeks, the adult flea is ready to emerge. But if conditions aren't right, and/or a host is not present nearby, they can remain in the pupal stage for several months. They are also safe from desiccation at this stage. When a host is found, the adult flea jumps onto the host and takes a blood meal. It feeds repeatedly and reproduces with other adult fleas. And the cycle begins anew. One gravid female flea can ingest up to 13.6 microliters of blood in the span of 24 hours. It's less than that of one adult hookworm, but imagine if you have a hookworm infection together with a flea infestation. On top of that, their bites are very itchy, especially when the dog or cat develops a hypersensitivity reaction towards their bites. In a hypersensitive animal, even just a few fleas can be intolerable. This condition is known as flea allergy dermatitis. When the dog chews on itself to relieve the itching, they may ingest a flea or two. Remember when the flea was a larva and it ingested Dipelidium caninum eggs? Well, that little egg developed into a cysticercoid as the flea matured. And when swallowed, infects its final host this way. I might make a video on that someday. Oh, it's also the intermediate host of Dipetalonema reconditum, a non-pathogenic subcutaneous filaria nematode that looks kinda like Dirofilaria immitis. The cat flea is also involved in the transmission of diseases like murine typhus and cat scratch disease in people. So, how do we get rid of the fleas? Fortunately, there are plenty of medications available for flea control. Unfortunately, that'll make the video really long, so I'm gonna have to break this video into two parts. Next video will be about flea control. Keep an eye out for it, and thank you for watching!